Francis, Executive Director of Redwood. So I want to welcome all of you here. I'm not going to take much time up here other than to thank you for trekking out in the midst of this. I grew up in Illinois, so there are a few flurries. My wife is from Arkansas, so down there this would be an absolute blizzard and a snowstorm. Everything would be shut down. So thanks for coming out. We have really quite a mix of people tonight, parents, legal folks, and others who are very glad you're here. I first wanted to introduce one of our board members. Redwood has two 501c3s, two entities, if you will. Redwood, which is where we are at now, and then our foundation board is the Dorothy Wood Foundation. So Stacy Tapke is one of our board members with the Dorothy Wood Foundation and also Kenton County Attorney. So I would like to turn the mic over to Stacy, who will in turn welcome you and introduce our special guests.
Again, everybody, welcome. My name is Stacy Tapke, and it's my honor to serve as the county attorney for Kenton County. I interact with some of the families at Redwood from time to time when their child is turning 18 and they see that they need a guardian and do guardianship through the office of the county attorney. And a few months back, I had the pleasure and opportunity of being down in the treasurer's office, and I was talking to Treasurer Ball and her staff. She would probably prefer that I call her Allison. I was speaking to her and her staff, and they were so excited to tell me about a new program that they are implementing, and that's the stable accounts that they're here to tell you about this evening. And they were very excited, and they wanted to make sure that all of the people across the Commonwealth of Kentucky were able to hear about the program. And I said, I know some folks that would love to hear from you. And that was sort of the genesis of the evening to try to coordinate. And I know we have people beyond just Redwood. We've got many other entities represented and parents from all across Northern Kentucky. And Allison, Treasurer Ball, she was elected in 2015, and she is the youngest female statewide elected officer in the whole United States. So that's pretty impressive. And on a personal note, I can tell you that she has a ton of energy. She's got a lot of passion for assisting those across the Commonwealth, and I can't be more excited to welcome her to the program this evening. And as she's coming up, I also want to introduce Samara Haverin, and she's the director of the Stable Accounts, and she's also going to be speaking, I believe, this evening. So please join me in a warm Northern Kentucky welcome for Treasurer Haverin.
Try and go up a little bit closer to everybody. I hope everyone can hear me okay. I know we're having a little bit of a hot mic. Can everybody hear me okay? All right, good, very good. Well, I kind of thought about the best way to handle this. This is a new program. We launched it on December 13th, so we're still figuring out all the best ways to utilize it and use it. But one of the key things about it is we need to get people involved in it. The program is only as good as the people using it. So that's why I'm here today to make sure all of you all are aware of it, know how to use it. How to tell other people about it, just make sure you're very informed about it. But so I thought the best way to do this, I can talk about it, but one of the best ways that we can make sure everybody's informed is if we do questions and answers and help you just kind of delve into what you want to know about it. So just I'll give you a nutshell of the program. Some of you may know a little bit about it. Is everybody familiar with the ABLE Act? Yes, okay, most people are. Well, I'm going to give you a little bit of a rundown just to make sure, and then we'll talk about the Kentucky version, which is Stable Kentucky. And you all are on the Ohio line, so you're probably familiar with what they've been doing in Ohio as well. Some of you might have seen some of the commercials that have bled over to this part of the country. So Stable Kentucky, and it's based on the ABLE Act a couple of years ago at the federal level. Congress made some changes in the law that made this possible. So the changes in the law were that if states wanted to, states could implement programs that would create savings and investment accounts for people with disabilities. And the reason why we needed congressional action on it is because, of course, there are all sorts of benefits and tax implications at the federal level. So the federal act, ABLE, it changed the law in that states could set up these accounts, and the accounts would be tax-free at the federal level, so there's no federal income tax on it, which is a huge change in the law, and it's great because it stretches money, makes it last a lot longer. And also, and this is probably the most key thing about it, is that it doesn't jeopardize benefits to certain levels. If you're receiving benefits and you open up one of these accounts, it's not going to impact it at a certain level. There would be a level where it would. Obviously, there's a cutoff at some point. But so, two things, federal tax-free, and then number two, that it doesn't affect your benefits that you receive at a certain level. You, in order to be able to open up one of these accounts, and actually there's a third component I want to make sure you all know about it, because it's also a major change in the law. These are the kinds of accounts that family members and friends can also contribute to, and it's not going to affect benefits that are being received. So some of you know that that's something that's been a really tricky landmine for folks, because families want to help out sometimes, and families, if they've helped out, it's actually put some people at risk for losing their benefits. So it's been an area people have to be very, very careful about. So that was the federal law. It made it so that way states could enact these types of programs if they wanted to. And I'm a bankruptcy attorney by trade. So one of the things that I learned practicing bankruptcy law is that you cannot be financially sound unless you've got an opportunity to save and invest. I think probably everybody in this room would agree with that. There's only so much you can do if you can't save and invest. You gotta be able to put some things aside and think about the future. So when I first heard about this program, I thought, this makes sense. A lot of my clients are people with disabilities. I knew firsthand, particularly where I'm from in Eastern Kentucky, we have a very high population of people with disabilities. So I knew right away this was something that could meet a need for folks, and I wanted to see about how can we implement this. So we started working on it last year, and we had, actually, you will like this. There were two members of the General Assembly from this part of the state, Senator Will Schroeder and State Representative Adia Wushner. Both of them got on board, and they were the ones who spearheaded the legislation to get this passed in Kentucky. So local people for you all, they were thinking of you when they did this. And then we talked about how do you actually implement the program. So they're the ones that made it so that way we could do this in Kentucky. And then I and my office have created the program and implementing it. Something that I need to make sure that everybody in this room is aware of is, well, before I get into that, let me give you a little bit more about background. Something that is great, I think, as far as, I'm a public servant. I'm a state treasurer, chief financial officer of the Commonwealth of Kentucky. I think all the time about taxpayer dollars and protecting them and guarding them. So that was one of the things that was a bit of a challenge with this program initially, because it was going to be very expensive. There's savings and investments accounts. That means that you have to hire investment brokers, and there's all sorts of federal laws that govern how you invest things. And when we were looking at this, we were looking at millions of dollars to implement the program. And we thought, we love this, we want to do it, it's great, we meet needs. But I'm not sure in Kentucky that we have the extra money to be able to pull this off. This is going to be very, very difficult. So we spent all last year brainstorming and figuring out how can we do this. And in the course of that, I started to have conversations with the Ohio State Treasurer, Josh Mandel. And he's very similar to me. He's a young office holder. He's in his late 30s, and we have a lot of ideological similarities. So we started talking about, how are you doing this in Ohio? What are you doing? What can we do? Can we learn from you all? And in the course of our conversations, we figured out that Kentucky can stand on the shoulders of Ohio a little bit. And so that's what we've done. Ohio was the very first state to open up ABLE accounts. They did it last summer. I believe it was in June, maybe in July. But it was the beginning of last summer to start these accounts. And we were, I think, the seventh state in the country to start doing this as well. So we were close on their heels starting in December. But my conversations with Josh up in Ohio, we figured out how to be able to utilize Ohio services. And we don't have to reinvent the wheel. We're using a lot of what they're doing in Ohio. And I've been able to use resources that we already have in our office and not use any additional taxpayer dollars. So, you know, as a fiscal conservative and somebody who's has as part of their actual core job is being a watchdog on spending, I was very pleased with being able to figure out how to do two things. One, help folks that have disabilities be able to save their bets as a bankruptcy attorney. You know, I understand how important that is. And then two, making sure I'm fulfilling my job as state treasurer by stretching taxpayer dollars. So I'm very pleased at how we've been able to develop this. I think it's doing everything that it needs to do. It's helping people on the front line, and it's being a good steward with taxpayer dollars. It's doing both of those things. Okay, that's the background of Stable Kentucky. That's what our Kentucky version is called. So you want to write that down. Make sure you get it. It's stable, like a horse's stable. We're in Kentucky, we think about horses a lot. So Stable Kentucky, and Kentucky is spelled out, one word. StableKentucky.com, and that's where you go to open up one of these accounts if you want to open one up. A little bit of nuts and bolts on it, just a little bit more before I open up for questions. In order to be able to open up one of these accounts, you have to have been determined to be disabled by the time you're 26 years old. So, and you can be older than 26 and have these accounts. A lot of people are. You just have to have been determined to be disabled before you're 26. Make sense with me? Okay, great. When you want to open the account, there's a little quiz that you go through that's pretty easy. I think it takes about 20 minutes total, top to bottom, to open up an account if you want to do it. So you just answer some questions. It's pretty intuitive, which I like. I don't want to spend a lot of time. I'm sure you won't feel the same way because we just fill out papers all the time. And this, I think, is a pretty easy way to do it. You just go on there and start answering questions about if you are eligible for the account. Then you can set it up. Once you have set it up, you have several decisions you have to make. Again, I told you it's a savings and investment account. So it's not just a way to put money in. You can start earning some money as well with it. So it depends on how you want to do it. You can do a super safe, conservative account. It can be basically savings, like a bank account. And you're not really taking any risk. And if you want to, there's four other types, and it's explained all on the website, so you don't have to remember all of this right now. When you go to the website, you can look at it. But those four other types are, depending upon how much risk you want to take with investing and how conservative you want to be with it. So it's different levels. And you can, if you want to, do your entire account one way, or you can divide it up. If you want to have, say, 20% of your account be a more of a high-risk investment and try and earn a lot of money back, and the rest of it you want to be just a savings account, you can do that. And a nice thing is that you're not locked in forever. You can change that if you want to. So you can create how you want to use this account, however you want to do it. A lot of ways to make it individualized. It is free to open the account, so you don't have to worry about paying something to start it. You do have to put in $50 in the very beginning. So you gotta make sure you put a little bit of money in when you start it up. After that point, you can put as little as a dollar in. Or more than that, so you have a lot of flexibility. Maintenance fees, right now the maintenance fees are $5 a month, and we've been talking with Ohio and trying to figure out how they've done things, and we have, I think, gotten to the point where we can lower it to $350 starting in April. So that's about comparable to what people have in bank accounts. There's a $350 a month maintenance fee. I think Samara's around here somewhere, she can confirm it. I think it ends up being about $42 a year, yes. So that's what it would cost to maintain it. And then depending upon your assets and how you invest, there are some fees, but they're nominal, and it'll show you on the website. And the reason I'm not going into it is because it would change depending upon your investments. So as you look into it, you can see that there's some assets-based fees, depending on how you figure all that out. So that's a nutshell version of it. When you actually use the account, you have to make sure that you're using it for qualified payments. And those qualified payments are broad. You can use them for education, you can use them for transportation, you can use them for housing, you can use it for basic living expenses, medical, of course, medical expenses. There's a whole list of options. You know, you can't, of course, go out on a vacation to Paris, you know, with it. That probably would be excluded. But unless it was somehow, there's some medical reason that you could explain and verify for doing it. But they are broad, and they meet most needs that a person would have and be able to use it. So you've got the money you put into it, it's going to be earning money back, it's going to grow, and you can use it for those qualified expenses. The actual way that you use it, you can do several different things. You can have money transferred into a bank account, you can have it sent as a check, or, I think this is great, this is a really handy tool for people. There are stable Kentucky cards. They're prepaid cards. They work like a debit card. And what you do is you can load a certain amount of money onto it, and then you can use that for the prepaid expenses. And I think that's probably the easiest way for folks to do it. You get to tailor it however you want to, whatever you like to do. But if you load money onto that card, you can just go into a store, go into the doctor's office or whatever it is, and you just pay it that way. And then the website has a way to mark down what you're using it for, so that we always have a backup to prove that you're using it for the qualified expenses. An additional piece of information when you're setting up the account is that of course, if you have SSI or SSD, those things prove that you have a disability and you are determined to have it before the age of 26. But you don't have to just have SSI or SSD. You can also have a diagnosis from a doctor, a physician. And as long as it meets those same types of standards, that's sufficient to open up one of these accounts. And you don't have to actually turn in that documentation unless you're requested from the IRS to do so. So you just make sure you've got it, you have it if you need it. But you don't have to scan it in and load it onto the website or anything like that. So that's one of the reasons why the website is very easy to use. Okay, that is a quick summary of all of it. Some other pieces of information that you need to know. You can put up to $14,000 a year into it, and then up to $100,000 at a time without affecting your benefits. You can load it up to that amount, and you actually can put more money into that as well. And the specific numbers are on the website, so you can see that. But you can put over $400,000 into a total, but because of the way the federal level is set up, that actually would impact what you'd be able to do with your disabilities. If you have more than 100,000 disabilities, if you're getting SSI or SSD or Medicaid, SSI and SSD would be suspended during the time period until it goes down to 100,000. So those are things that you would bear in mind. It's all on the website. So don't feel like you have to get every single piece of information down right now, but those are things to remember as you're utilizing this. And I don't think Medicaid is affected by the $100,000. You can look into that too on the website. And Samara can back me up on that as well if we need more information on that. Very good. I think that is a summary of the program. And I can open this up for more questions if you've got them. Yes? Yes. It still has money in it. That is a tremendous question, and the answer to that is not yet. But there are efforts being made right now to change that. What would you do with it? And that's a great question. That's why there are efforts being made to that. So if anybody can hear the question, she had established a 529 account, which those are accounts that people use to pay for college tuition. Invest into it and their tax advantage programs. And so the question is, can you transfer those funds to an ABLE account? The answer is, at this point in time, not yet, but there are people that are working at that. Part of that has to come from the federal level. And I've actually heard discussions that even this year that there are efforts to change that and make them something. It makes sense to me because it seems like it's a similar purpose. And it's something that I'm very supportive of as well. I think it'd be a great idea. And I've actually been talking to people about do we need to make changes at the state level to make that happen. And most of that's going to have to come from the federal level. Efforts are being made on that, and I'm going to be working on it from my end. It needs to be done on that as well. But great question. A follow-up, yes.
Can you do auto-deposits or pull down the bank account?
You can have a transfer from your bank account. I think it depends upon what you have with your bank about whether or not you can do the auto. And actually, that may be a good Samara question.
Yes, I'm Samara. I'm the director of Stable Kentucky. Kind of a disclaimer for everybody, you know, unfortunately, ABLE accounts have not been available for a year yet. So it's very new to Kentucky, and so we're still learning along the way as we work with Ohio. So any question that I'm not able to answer tonight, I will definitely get back with you by tomorrow or Wednesday with an answer. You know, this is such an incredible program that we want to be able to give you the correct answer. So that is something I will actually double check on, because I don't want to give you the wrong answer and then come back and like, oh, actually not. So I will get your contact information before the end of the night, and then I will work with Lauren as well, and maybe she can send out a mass email for everybody.
Great. Yes.
Is the deadline to put money into the 2016 tax year April 15th, or is it the end of 2016?
Great. That's a great question. That may be a summary question as well. We actually started in December so people could open up their accounts before the end of the year. And that was our deliberate intention to do that, start December 13th. So I think, well, I'm not sure. Let me pass it on to the director and see if we've got a definitive answer.
I will get back with you on that. I promise they will have an answer.
Yes.
No problem.
Okay.
So, yes, so another one. Another good question. Yes, another good question. So they're not trusts. So just good to remember the two of them are different. Yes.
Family members
that want
to put their ally, my son, as
a beneficiary, yes. Yeah. So the answer to that would be whoever the person is who has the disability is the technical owner of the account. However, you can't have a guardian or power of attorney or somebody like that who can actually be running the account. So ownership is going to belong to the person with a disability, but you can designate or just by virtue of the fact you've got a guardian, that other person can be the one who's actually maintaining it, making decisions, utilizing it. So it's very similar to what you just described as a trust, except that there's a technical difference whether the owner is actually the person with a disability. And if you do make that decision to have somebody else be the one who's in charge of the account, only that person would be the one able to use the account. The person who was the technical owner of it wouldn't be able to make decisions on it anymore.
Actually, what happened was, like, my dad wanted to give him funds upon his own.
Oh, right.
So he wanted to put out the beneficiary, and I'm like, no.
It's not the same thing, right.
Alex
would be, it's not a beneficiary because it's not a trust. So that would be a distinction between the two. So what it would be is, if your grandfather or Alex's granddad was setting up the account, it would be Alex's account. But granddad can put money into it. Did that make sense?
She wants to. He dies and he wants to will money.
Right.
Can he put it to the account?
Yeah, can the executor do that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think that'd be a problem. Yeah.
It's not over $15,000.
Because you've got a max of what you can put in that year. As long as it goes straight into that account. No, as long as it goes straight into that account, then you're not going to have any issues with that. Because you'd have to prove that it would have to actually go into the account, yes. Because the only things that are going to be tax-free and aren't going to jeopardize the funds are things that are into that account. But they can come in.
Like an IRA where if you receive the money, it's taxable instead of transferring directly
into the account. Right. Well, I think you'd have to make sure that it goes straight into the account. Like, he doesn't have any ownership of it until it goes into the account. You'd have to name that. You probably, in order to be absolutely certain that you've done it right, you probably have to say through the ABLE account. Because you wouldn't want it to go to him and then into the account, right? Exactly. You don't want his ownership of it to vest until it's inside the account.
I believe it can be considered a gift because that's a gifting. You could gift him to it. So he could gift him that money.
It would just have to go straight.
But it would have to go straight to the Stengel account. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
I just think that in the will, you have to actually state that it's going to go into that way. Yeah, you have to go into a stable account. Because the way that you could have a problem with it is if it actually goes to him. Right, exactly. Everything that's inside that account is protected, but you don't want it to go in between. Yeah.
So let me make sure I understand that.
Yes.
If during that year, you already put $6,000 in that account, then this person with willingness in that account can only put $8,000 in that account, right?
Yeah, that would be correct. You have to be careful about that because you do have that $14,000 a year limit, yes. And then, of course, $100,000 over time. So, yeah, you'd have to be mindful of that. Good question. Yes? No, it's one account because the big thing to remember is that it belongs to the person. Yeah, so they get one account. And in fact, I think at this point in time, the only way you could transfer an account, because we're just talking about 529s, is you can transfer an account if a child passed away or someone who had one passed away. They are permitted to transfer it to a sibling who also has a disability. So it's limited.
Our agency serves as representative payee for most individuals that live in our program. Can we serve as their, the power of attorney to be the, handler of the account?
Yeah, I'm going to turn over to Samara, but I think the answer to that is yes. I think anyone, as long as they have the proper documentation, they can have power of attorney.
And if they have a card, you have to sign the power of attorney to allow them to.
Yeah, but then you would have to be the one in charge of all the decisions that are related to that account, obviously. Yes.
Yes, you're correct. Yeah, that's it. Yes.
Very good.
I have a question.
Yes.
You said that Medicaid didn't think it was affected by Medicaid has some coverage, so that's obviously.
Yes, it does.
Died.
Yes.
And there's any inheritance or anything that is still in that child's name where they can come back and recover their costs. Is this accessible for them to recover the costs?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And ABLE accounts are different than just regular bank accounts when it comes to Medicaid payback. So yes, it is subject to payback, but not entirely. You're allowed to pay for burial expenses, funeral expenses out of that without it affecting the Medicaid payback.
Prior to, yes, exactly.
I think technically they would have access to it, but you would have the ability to be able to use those funds. So they're not going to be paid back until you decide what you're doing with it, if that makes sense. That's probably a little nuanced. So you can pay the funeral and burial expenses. If there are any outstanding qualified expenses that haven't been paid yet, those can go be paid. And I think, and you can correct me if I'm wrong on this, but this is a very technical difference, is that the Medicaid can only get paid back for what they have paid for after you open the account. So say, for example, prior to opening the account, you had a $10,000 surgery. And then after opening the account, you had a $2,000 surgery. But you've got, they would only be able to get paid back for what was opened up for the two, not for the 10 prior to opening the account. It's only what was spent after the account was opened.
Well, I guess my concern is we had a secondary insurance for GAPA.
Yes.
And our son was in the hospital, okay. And it did have that Medicaid was a secondary provider. We qualify for the reimbursement for expenses, but we could receive it from Medicaid procedure. So that's why I asked the question.
This would be the time of death.
If that's the case, it would be the same thing. I don't really have direct access to it yet. It's a qualifying event. Death is a qualifying event for us to be able to access it to pay for it. But Medicaid is the first hand in, which means Medicaid gets it. We don't touch it at all. That's why I asked how we find out for sure if that's how.
Well, I know for sure. I know for sure that's what's supposed to happen. That the ABLE accounts, right? The ABLE accounts, yeah. And I think we just have to see, since this is all new. I'm not even sure anyone's had this happen yet, because it's they've only been out for the last few months. But that's the way it's supposed to happen. Sure.
Yeah.
Yes, and. Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. So as Treasurer Wells said, this is how it's supposed to happen. Of course, supposed. With the paper trail and everything. But this is, this is how it should be. The estate. Because this is one of the questions that we had before we came. Is what happens to the remaining money in the stable account when the disabled person dies? I'm going to read it word for word, just so it's correct. So if the individual had a sibling with a disability, you could, of course, transfer the account to that sibling. That's the only allowable transfer. Yes. The estate should notify the stable account that the individual has passed away. We will tell them what documentation is needed to verify that fact. And generally, we talked to the Life Plan of Kentucky last week. And they also kind of reiterated this as to, they really encourage folks to prepay funeral and burial expenses so you don't have to worry about that as the estate administrator, which of course that's, that's personal, that's your decision. But the administrator, once for the individual estate, will be given access to the stable account once able receives the proper documentation, and the estate can pay for funeral, burial, expenses, amounts. It's paid for the individual starting after the date the account was opened, minus the amount of Medicaid buy-in premiums that the person paid during their lifetime.
That's important to remember, that what you pay your premiums is exempt from Medicaid, so that they can't get that. So you've got certain money that you know, even if it's not a qualified expense, and even if it doesn't go to the funeral and burial costs, that portion of it is protected.
And then something with Medicaid payback. Unfortunately, this is not unique to stable accounts. Anyone on Medicaid will be subject to Medicaid payback, although a lot of times this is, you know, something new for everybody. You know, it's very important that the person's money is better protected in a stable account than it would be in just a regular bank account. And if it's just sitting in a regular bank account, Medicaid can kind of take all of it without the estate even being able to spend it first, without the timing restrictions favorable to stable. So really with the stable account, it is in favor of that Medicaid just can't come take it like they can in a regular bank account. Yes.
Either SSDI or medical doctor.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
How would a trust change this?
Yeah, well, one thing is cheaper. It's easier to set up.
Don't so, think you have a trust in job time. Does that affect this?
No, it wouldn't. This would be a simply separate entity. Yeah, well, that's one of the things that was debated in congressional. So, you know, one of the things that was debated is this taking advantage of the system, and Congress determined that the system was actually penalizing certain people. So that it was just, that was debated, and that was decided at the end. So, I mean, there are some people that probably would take the position if you just asked, but enough people decided that it wasn't, that this was an area that needed to be changed for people that happened. Hopefully it will.
Just essentially, I mean, you have legal documents to say this is valid from the law.
Sure.
And so now you're going to create another asset base?
Yeah, hopefully. I mean, the purpose of it is designed to fix the problem. So hopefully it will. And a difference between a trust and an account like this is that this was created, the opportunity of it was created at federal level, whereas trusts are a creature of state law. You know, this was a creature, so to speak, of the federal level. So that should put it in a little bit of a different situation because it's coming from that level. Yeah. But I mean, there's always a possibility of problems. It's just that this is trying to address and fix the problem. And you know, we'll keep working on it and hoping that we catch everything that needs to be caught on it.
Is that trying to push people out of creating trusts?
No, it's supposed to be helping because trusts are expensive. So it really is a way to help particularly people that are low income have a way to be able to save the best. Because, I mean, it was noticed that if you can only save $2,000, that's not a lot of money. I remember one woman came and talked to me when we first started the accounts, and she said that she's got a job, and she has a van that she uses, a particular van that's designed to help with her disability, but it's not working. And so it's been really hard for her to figure out how to get to work, and she's not been able to save enough money to fix it because it would cost more than $2,000. So she said, this is like the answer to a prayer for her. She actually started crying because she said, this is exactly what she's needed to be able to save the best money. So yeah, this is not to replace trusts. It's because there are a lot of people who will decide trusts are better for them, and you've got the money and the resources to do that. You know, that's a decision that people will make individually. But this is something else because there's so many folks that don't have the resources to be able to create trusts. And
yeah, and let me share just a few of it. You know, in our presentation, we always talk about how it's meant to complement a special needs trust rather than, you know, competition for it. You know, it's cost effective, broader spending power, so you can use it for housing. You know, it's easy access, easy closure, no federal income tax on earnings, no separate returns to file, and can be established, administered, and owned by the individual with a disability.
Yeah. Actually, that's one of the nice things about it is that it gives people more control over their decisions and their lives individually, which, you know, from the kind of perspective that I come back on, being a bankruptcy attorney, I love people being able to make decisions for their lives and being able to work and contribute, to think about the future. Yes.
I have a question still on the state recovery. Yes. A guardian and kids are, if they contribute money in to the account, is that part of, is Medicaid able to get that in the state recovery?
My understanding is that Medicaid is always able to take money back once they pay it at the time of death. And that this one at least creates exceptions, whereas without it, then there's no exception. So that's always going to be an issue.
Can the individual themselves
put money in? Yes. In fact, most people will do it that way. Most people are setting them up for themselves. It's just that you have a lot of people who are guardians who also do it.
So hypothetically speaking, if you have an individual who is on a waiver, on SS, and working a job, and they have to worry about the $2,000 paper, which is like $7.21 that a month before Medicaid starts taking it, as back to your case management. Can the person put the money in there to shield it from?
That's what it's for.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the purpose of it. Yeah. Yes. I think she may have had it at first. Yes.
Fine.
So, Medicaid, you get to that portion, if there's any money left, will that be just returned to whomever, the federal tax?
Let me pass that over to you.
That's a good question. I believe I have that answer somewhere, if you will give me a second to find it. Girl, you are wearing me out. I'm just kidding. No, we have lots of, no, these are great, because then in future presentations, we'll be able to share those answers. So let me look, because I actually think I have that. So let me look, and I'll get right back with you.
Looking, I want to share two pieces of information because you touched on something. I know that housing is a little bit different if you're receiving benefits. So one of the things that you need to be mindful of, if you're actually paying for your housing out of your ABLE account, it's a qualified expense, you're allowed to do it, you can do it, you're encouraged to do it, but you have a timing issue with that one. You have a month, that calendar month, you have to make sure you pay the mortgage or the rent or whatever it is in the same calendar month that you withdrew it. So that's one of those little pieces of information that is important to remember. Yes.
Yeah, I have a tax
credit.
You mentioned that earnings are not subject to federal tax.
That's right. And we're working at the state level. Yeah. I'm still working on it. Actually, there's some legislation right now that would do that. But because of the way the General Assembly is set up right now, the governor has indicated that he wants all tax issues to be in a special session.
Okay.
So we're thinking that it's not going to pass now. We're going to work on it as to be implemented during the special session.
What about, like, I know in Ohio, they have a 529 plan.
Yes.
That
actually is a question I'm not sure there's an answer to. I was looking over some of my notes on that, and I don't think there's an answer to that yet. In fact, I know there isn't. That's actually one of the things that we've been talking about addressing in the next tax session. So I'm not sure internally what because it's also new, what it would be, but we're working on getting that statutorily, definitively decided.
And one other question, somewhat.
About deductions.
Somewhat unrelated, but what about transferability? Like if a person was living in Kentucky, had to go to Ohio, and they transferred from one state account to another?
That is a good question. So you have to be within Kentucky to open up the account. I know the answer to that. If you were to go to another state, your account would still be the same, but you'd be subject to some higher fees because you'd no longer be a Kentucky resident. I don't think that it would be a lot at this point. It may change over time. I don't think that it would change the Medicaid payback.
Right.
Medicaid payback only is triggered when somebody dies.
Okay.
Could you transfer? I don't think the way the law is set up right now, you could. That's a good question. That may be I haven't seen it happen yet. Do you know the answer to that? If you could you.
California has an ABLE account, whatever they call it.
Yeah.
And could I roll it from here to that
cancel your Kentucky account, transfer the funds to it? That's a good question.
You can keep your stable account, but you would no longer get the benefits of our lowered annual investment fees.
Right. But I think she's asking you to close the account and transfer it.
Over into their able account in that state, and I'm going to let it die in for the rest of my life without any penalty.
Right. You just close out the account and transfer it. Yeah, I'm not sure that, I know the answer, it may depend on the state. Well, they can, right, and I think it would be.
But it's, that's an indication that that's a state, just as different as a state for individual accounts.
Right, right. I think it might depend upon the particular, probably would depend somewhat upon the particular state that you would move to. Yeah, Kentucky, we're utilizing Ohio services, so we're mirroring everything they're doing. Yeah, we're mirroring everything that they're doing. But you have to be in Kentucky in order to be able to, right, yes.
Similar question for 529. The caps that you mentioned,
yes.
Are those caps in place for all 529 plans, whether it's 529 education or 529A stable national accounts, or is it particular to the state?
This is particular to ABLE accounts, which is the federal, yes, yeah. Yeah, these particular limitations are ABLE specific. I think when you're doing a school 529, the rules are different.
Yeah, okay.
Good question. I know, as we figure out, and that's one of the, yes, I know. Right, limiting, yeah, how much you can do it, yes. That's one of those overly complicated, like, how do we handle this problem? But I do think that it's pretty positive that they'll be able to figure out a way to do the 529 ABLE. If someone were to become disabled, can't use your 529 anymore. Yeah, it just makes sense. They're very similar creatures anyway. Yes?
Would you be able to change the administrator, like from guardian to department of education to, like, one of our individuals from our agency to another agency, and they would be able to take over?
I think that's an urgent scenario. I'm not sure we've actually had that come up yet, but.
So in order to move it, it's going to be with a power of attorney, a guardian, or that individual. So as long as yeah, but they've got to be the individual's power of attorney or guardian. But yes, as long as they're that figure, then yes, they can.
Yes.
I
don't know if you'll be able to answer this. So there's been a lot of discussion.
The software, when you open up an account online, it actually has a little place for you to write down what you're spending your money on.
Oh, no, I meant in Medicaid's eyes. Oh. What they think I've charged them. That's what I meant. Like, is there some place you can procure that? Or is anyone aware of that?
The last I knew is you would have contact Medicaid and you'd have to make a request for itemized explanation of the DOD, just like you get from your insurance. And they would have to produce that, even think your documentation is for all the expenses that will apply to Medicaid and then submitted and reimbursed, whether it's to school, whether it's to the agency or whoever, for the total cost. They can do that. You can request it. They don't like it, but you do have the right to do that.
So they should have a historic record going back to
every year. Oh, yeah.
Yes.
So let's say the person has this account, they have money in it, and they pass away, and they don't have a sibling with a disability. What happens?
Yeah, that's a great. That's one of the questions I was asked earlier. I think, do you know the answer to that? Right. There's no Medicaid payments.
That's going to be a question that I'm going to ask.
for you? That's going to be a question that I ask for you and get you an answer back on.
You know, I think that the major member was that the purpose of it is to make sure people with individual disabilities can pay for things they need related to their disability. So I would think the purpose would cease in time of purpose, the person's death. Like, you can continue to pay for those things that are due, that are qualified expenses. But I would imagine, I probably shouldn't speculate, but I would imagine that at the time of death, those qualified payments can't be made anymore.
Because you wonder if they died unexpectedly.
Right.
And they had like
100,000 or right, I would imagine that at that point in time, because you're not going to be able to spend it for any qualified expenses after that, other than funeral, burial, things that you know that you can pay. I would think that once that ability is no longer there, because you can actually pay out of ABLE accounts for non-qualified expenses. Like, you can say in there, I'm using this for something else. But if you do that, then that money is subject to tax, and it just changes how it's done. And I think there actually may be a penalty for using funds for non-qualified expenses. Is there a penalty? Okay. Do you want to hand it to you?
Is there a survivorship?
Right, and that's what I'm just speculating on this, but I think that at that point of survivorship, I would think the tax advantages that were created to help the individual person with disability, that purpose wouldn't be there anymore. So I think we would use that regular funds, just me guessing.
But you need to be able to designate.
Yeah,
I don't think that's going to be subject to taxation, but they are going to be able to designate. Say, for example, this
right.
Typical sibling who is not handicapped, will they be able to inherit that money should that person die and be?
Yeah, this is me speculating, so this is a little bit of a. But I would imagine, I probably shouldn't even speculate, but I would imagine that you no longer have those qualified expenses, so it's going to be treated like regular funds, just regular funds. And that it still belong to the individual. They're just not going to have all these tax advantages and right, but it's still on the state.
Yeah.
That would just depend upon
That is one of the questions that I will get to Lauren, and then she will, if you want to give me your email address, I will give you an answer to all the questions answered here tonight, or I can get that to Lauren and she will forward that out to everybody. But we want to make sure to give you all the right answer on that.
Contribute that to Redwood or to an educational institution in that child's name.
Right.
Okay, and that's a contribution to an education institution, which is
qualified expenses.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. So that might be where there's no penalty with the contribution on that as a contributor to the deduction. It goes back to your not knowing.
Right. So it's a trigger. It's a new. Yeah.
You know, it counts as a deduction on their taxes. So if that was the case,
right,
we'd be able to do that.
Well, and the one thing I think that might make that difference is it has to be the child using that qualified expense, or the adult use was determined to be disabled by 26.
I want to answer the tax penalty question that someone asked over here. I'm not sure who, but there are tax penalties. You know, you have to pay taxes plus 10% penalty of the earnings portion of the withdrawal. So an example that we use is if you contribute $90 to your account and you make $10 in earnings, your balance is now $100. You withdraw that $100 but not use it for a qualified expense, you must pay regular income taxes plus 10% on the $10. So it depends on the income tax on your state.
So I mean, I think it would just make the funds like non-qualified expense funds that you're paying. Yes. Like when you have that one already?
My question is, like he's 15, we put money in it, and something comes up that's not covered by the waiver or whatever, is there an age limit to where he can pull the funds out or something?
No, it would be his as long as he's determined to be disabled. So if for some reason he was no longer disabled.
18 or whatever, he can pull the money out.
Oh, I see what you're saying. He's a minor on his account. Right. Okay, let me throw that over to you.
There is not an age.
So I think, you know, if you have a minor, like, you know, if you have a minor on the account, it would be the guardian.
It would be the guardian that does. Does that make
sense?
Yes.
Who do you contact in all the gray areas?
Well, that's the, us. You contact us. The thing is, there's gray areas because it's so new. So we're also trying to figure out exactly how this is going to be implemented. Yeah, it is.
We'll contact Ohio and ask them because they must have had this question. Because this is part of Ohio, they're the ones that we've been saying for it, not the mail work of their customer service, which is stable account.
Yeah, since Ohio was first, they've had a few more instances than we have.
Are the numbers available on the website?
Yeah, well, you can go to the website and see everything that's known right now. And if there's something more technical, it could be that it's a situation that hasn't actually arisen yet. Because, like, again, we just started December 13th, so, you know, I can answer what we've anticipated and what we know of for sure. Sometimes there are complicating factors because you've got other departments, and you're not always sure exactly how people will interpret things. But we're as we're developing it and as we know. Sure.
How are you all?
Well, again, it's that federal level. The federal level changed the law for Social Security. So it made it so that way states can, if they want to, take advantage of those changes in the law. So that's how. Great. Oh, good. Yes. Yeah, very good. It's Vanguard and, you know, very well respected. Yeah, institution member. Yes. And if you want to, well, that's why you've got the options to be able to set up, like, I want to invest this much, or I don't want to invest anything. Like, you can say, too. Yeah, of course. That's for take the chance. Yes.
There is one account that's FDIC approved. And so, of course, you're not going to get any investment on that, but your money will be safe, so you won't lose anything.
That's why earlier when I was talking about if you want to do a super safe, just savings account, you can do it that way if you want to. But if you want to, and again, something I like about it is that you have the ability to be able to say, okay, I want 10% of the money I'm putting in here to be invested. And I want to invest it. There's four different kinds of investments.